Well, I started out down a dirty road. Started out all alone. And the sun went down as I crossed the hill. And the town lit up. The world got still. I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. Coming down is the hardest thing. Well, the good old days.
All right, a little Tom Petty bringing us into this edition of the Loudmouth Pastor Podcast. My name's Bob Evans. Welcome back. Been a while since we got a new episode out. Been putting some sermons up on YouTube and on the podcast just to keep you satisfied in an auditory fashion. Well, it's the second last day of August.
Yes.
Yes, and this is my friend Vicki Krahn. She comes to my church, and we're in the same life group together. And Vicky's been coming for probably 4 or 5 years now.
I think it's closer to six now.
Closer to 6 years? Yeah. Wow. One day, Kevin and Vicki walked into the church, the school. We have church in an elementary school with Nash, their son. And I got to know Vicki a little bit on the school PAC, the Parent Advisory Council, right?
Yep.
And then I'm like, so what are you guys doing here? Are you here to pick up some homework? And then Vicki goes, no, Nash wanted to come to church.
That's right.
And I'm like, Nash wanted to come to church. Oh, cool. Well, welcome. And you guys have been coming ever since?
Ever since.
Yeah.
It's
almost been 6 years?
That's what Nash said, yeah. And he's got the best memory out of all of us, so.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That's crazy. That's crazy. Yeah, he's a sharp kid.
Yes.
Yeah, he remembers that stuff. He's like Captain Trivia, as well as many other things.
Oh, yes.
Yes. So, Vicki and I were talking. Actually, Nash is the one that gave me the idea for this, your son.
Okay.
We were having junior youth on Thursday night, and I was telling the kids, you guys are about to enter high school, and you're going to find out very quickly that you're going to get tempted to do some things that will suck the life out of you if you're not careful. I said, to be cool, you will start to do things like drugs or go to parties and start drinking, and you're going to have to be guarded and remember that now's the time to make a decision before you enter the school that you're not going to be too cool to do the right thing. You got to be able to do the right thing, because it'll trap you, that kind of lifestyle. And we've seen that many times, right?
Oh, huge.
And yeah. Nash puts his hand up like he does, and he holds it up until I ask him what's going on. He says, well, I wanted to tell you about my mom's life. And I said, and we were done. It was 8 o'clock, and he goes, yeah, you should have let me say something. I said, well, what's it about? And he says, well, you got to talk to my mom about her life. And now we're going to rewind the tape a bit. So yesterday
I took my 15-year sobriety cake. My birthday was actually on the 9th of August. The 8th of August, 2002, was my last drink.
2002.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Yeah.
15 years.
15 years.
Wow, that's awesome.
So, yeah.
That's pretty cool. So, where were you born?
I was born in Sicamous. I was born and raised in this little town. And went through school here. Had a normal life. Two parents. They both worked. They were both recovering alcoholics. And when I was 14 years old, my dad was diagnosed with terminal cancer, and within 5 months, he died.
Wow.
So you take a teenager going through puberty, going into high school, and having a tremendous event like that happen.
That's horrible.
Yeah. I knew that God was a loving God, but then 2 months after my dad died, my aunt stuck a 22 in her mouth.
Oh, no.
Yeah. These are the parts that I've never told you all about. Within the next year and a half, we had 4 more family members die.
Wow.
I ended up turning away from God. I always knew he loved me, But at that
time, how did you know that? How did you know God loved you? Did you hear about him, or were you at church?
I was raised. My mom baptized us as Anglican. I don't remember going to church a lot.
Yeah.
But I remember we were baptized Anglican, and my mom always taught me that God was a loving God. He wasn't a condemning God. He loved everybody equally,
mm-hmm.
no matter what they did.
She had that right.
Yeah. And I was the one that turned away from him. I was mad at him because he took people I loved. I didn't trust him anymore.
Yeah.
So probably the next 15 years, I went down a very dark highway.
How'd that start, the dark highway? You were 14 when all this happened?
Yeah.
15?
Yeah, 14. My dad died in March. I turned 15 in May of that year. So, I started, like any teenager, not knowing which direction they're going to go and where they're going to fit in or anything else.
Mm-hmm.
I started drinking with the rest of the kids. And
just a high school thing?
Yeah. Yeah, and then, you know, pretty soon it was, because back then they didn't ID people as much to go in bars or anything else, or
mm-hmm.
you brought somebody else's ID with, and they'd let you in and everything else. So, I mean, I was going to the bars when I was 16.
Mm-hmm.
And, it soon progressed very badly. To the point where I was actually fairly well intoxicated at my high school graduation, and my principal, mm-hmm. when I went and got my diploma, shook my hand and actually said, "I won't miss you."
Hmm.
I know. Oh, I won't miss you either. So.
So you were kind of in a zone where that was just a regular thing. Now where
it
you
was
were intoxicated
regular.
A lot of the time.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Every
weekend was there a party, or?
Oh, I drank every day, and every weekend was a party. Yeah, I'd get off work at 10 or 11 at night and hit the bar, and so that I could catch up, I'd have doubles. I wouldn't have singles. And I'd order it by the jug. Then I hit, I met Kevin, and we were together, I think, about 8 or 9 years before I hit my bottom. And then I decided that, you know what, I knew where the help was. I knew where to get it.
And where was that?
I decided to follow my parents' footsteps and go through the doors of AA, Alcoholics Anonymous.
Okay.
The first step there is admitting you have a problem, that your life is unmanageable.
Yeah.
That part I knew. The second one is turning your will and your life over to the care of God as you understand Him.
Mm-hmm.
And
was that hard to do when you were mad at him for all his family that died?
No, because I was at my bottom. I was giving up. And I knew that I couldn't control it. I couldn't control my drinking. I couldn't control my life. I had to believe in something else. And because I knew at that point that it was either change or die.
Mm. So what brought you to the, you realized you had a problem. Do you remember a moment where you realized, like, I have hit bottom, I need help? Do you remember a moment, or was it just a week or a month or a year where you realized it? You're a friend to do an intervention? How did you kind of come to that realization?
There was never really any interventions. I would drink till I blacked out. And when I was drinking, I was, alcoholics tend to be very selfish and self-centered. It's about them. And if they're in pain, they want everybody else around them to be in pain. They want to bring them down. And I was very mean, not physically. With my tongue, the words I would say to people.
Really?
Yeah.
Knowing you, I wouldn't expect that.
No, I know.
Yeah. Huh.
And that's who I was, right? There wasn't very many people that wanted to be around me anymore.
So you're painting yourself into a lonely corner.
Yes.
Hmm.
And yeah, it was a very sad existence.
Hmm.
And so, like I said, knowing how much the program helped my parents, and I, you know, of course, with them being in the program, I knew other people in the AA program, and I knew it worked.
Mm-hmm.
And they say in there, it works if you work it.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's what I do now. And you turn your will over to God, and you let go, and you let God. And that's part of, you know, I find a lot of parallels between Bob's preaching and the program that I practice. Because there's things like, you know, we can pray to God and we want answers. But we want those, I call them fast food answers. We want to be able to go through the drive-thru, say, here's my problem, I want an answer.
Mm-hmm.
Drive up to the next window and they're going to hand you the answer.
Right.
That's not how life works. That's not how God works.
Mm.
So we need to be able to let go of things and allow God to bring us the answers in His time.
I once was lost, but now I'm found. Once was lost, but now I'm found. So far away, but I'm home now. Once was lost, but now I'm found. And now my life song sings. I once was blind, but now I see. I once was blind, but now I see. I don't know. When He touched me, I once was blind, but now I see. And now my life song sings. And now my life song sings. And now my life song sings. Once was
faith. You read, you talk to people who have similar, you know, experiences in life, similar beliefs and values.
Mm-hmm.
And today I have those friends that I can be, male and female, that I can be completely open and honest with.
Mm-hmm. Be real.
Be real.
Yeah.
And, you know, through the program and through coming to church, I said last night when I was taking my cake, is that it has given me the tools to teach my son how to recognize feelings and how to deal with feelings. And that, you know what? It's okay to talk about things. And it's okay to be real.
Mm-hmm.
And it's okay to say, I'm scared. I don't want to do this.
Hmm.
And
that's good.
You know?
And in a Canadian culture, where politeness and reservedness is big, right?
Mm-hmm.
In Canadian culture.
Yes.
We're not taught to be real.
Not at all.
We're programmed to be nice.
Yes.
Even though we're falling apart on the inside.
Yeah.
You don't hassle people with that. You don't admit it. You be the nice Canadian, but really,
you're breaking inside.
It's cowardly, really.
Yeah.
Because you're not going to the real place of saying, you know, I messed up today. I'm not having a good day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And today, today I can say that.
That's a good thing.
You know what? I'm lost. Yeah. And I'm lucky enough that I have a coworker who is also a Christian. So when we're at work and his wife laughs because she said, you two have worked together long enough, you sound like siblings.
Mm-hmm.
We can actually talk to each other and be real with one another. And he's gone through some things in his life that he's gone through a recovery of a different sort. So we talk a lot on those parallels. And both being Christian, I think, helps one another.
Why did you were in Alcoholics Anonymous? It was working.
Yes.
Because you're 15 years clean.
Yes.
So I'm just doing some math and it takes me a while.
That's okay.
So you've been coming to church for 6 years.
Yep.
That's like 9 years of it's working for you for 9 years in Alcoholics Anonymous.
Yeah.
You're getting clean.
Yeah.
You've got friends. You're experiencing victory over the addiction. Why then did you want to start coming to church? Because in our church, what we say and declare and believe that who God is Jesus Christ.
Yes.
So what would draw you to 6 years ago, even though it's working for you, what would draw you to want to come to church to get to know Jesus and people better?
Nash, our son,
met
Mason through school.
And Mason's a buddy of Nash.
Yeah.
Yeah, they both come to youth.
And they became very good friends. We live right down the road from one another. And one day, I can't remember if we were having dinner or what. And I remember we were sitting at the kitchen table. And he said, Mason and his family go to church. I said, yes, they do, because I had spoken with Monica, who is Mason's mom.
Yeah.
And he said, I think I'd like to go and see what it's like. So I looked across the table at my husband and said, what do you think? Like, I don't mind going, right? And it was funny because then Kevin said, well, I thought about going, but I wasn't sure how you guys would feel or how to bring it up. So we started going, and I mean, we were welcomed with open arms and some surprise. And we've been going ever since. We thoroughly enjoy it. And
but when you started coming to Shuswap Community Church,
yes,
at the school, was there anything that you didn't expect about God or Jesus? Would you say that that's the first time you got to know Him for yourself?
Yes, that is the first time we actually. Well, I can speak for myself that I got to know Him for myself. My mom, like, we never read the Bible at home. My mom may have read it. I don't remember ever reading it, even as a child. I think we may have gotten baptized close to when, either right before my dad got sick or when he was sick. And I think that was the issue of the godparents and in case something happened to her.
Right.
And that part I remember, but I don't remember attending a lot.
Okay.
So yes, coming to Shuswap Community Church was the first time that we really got to know Jesus. And
amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My
chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains unending.
To know Him when you started coming to our church? Do you remember a moment or a Sunday or a month or a period of time where you were like, you had an aha moment or anything like that? Or was it a process? What was it like
for you? It was more of a process for me, because I think, and as I said earlier, it's when I started recognizing the parallels of the teaching of the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
And things that I had already learned in life, whether it be through the program or through my parents or family or whatever, the parallels that, you know, He's loving and that He's not a condemner like a lot of people through recovery seem to think that He is, not necessarily the people that go to church. But that was one of the big things that I learned in recovery, was that a lot of people were raised with a very condemning God. That if you were bad, God was going to get you. If you did this, God was going to get you. If
right.
you did this. And coming to church was that none of us are perfect. We're all a work in progress.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
We all make mistakes.
We're all a mess.
Yeah. We all have to ask for forgiveness, even, you know, from small things to big things.
Mm-hmm.
And so to find a church that had the same belief system as what I did, because I'd heard of this condemning God in all these other churches,
mm-hmm.
I felt like, okay, this is where I belong.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
He is loving and He is forgiving,
mm-hmm.
and none of us are perfect. although some, you know, I think some seem to think they are, but maybe that's my perception of things. I'm not sure.
I don't really know anybody in our church that seems to think they have it all together.
No.
That's a good thing.
Yeah.
That's a good thing, because that's when we're in trouble, I think, right? So if you were to picture Jesus in Sycamus today, like let's say you're in Askew's, the grocery store,
yep.
and or Timmy's, you're sitting down, mm-hmm. we're drinking Timmy's right now.
Yeah.
So let's say you're sitting in Timmy's having a coffee, and Jesus walks in. How do you picture him in your mind's eye? What's he like?
He's the guy that's gonna, you know, either sit down at the table across from a group of youth and, you know, maybe just listen for a bit,
mm-hmm.
maybe, you know, start talking to them. Physically, I'm not sure what he would look like,
mm-hmm.
but I think I know what he would do.
Hmm.
You know, because from what I've learned is that, and I actually had this discussion with someone that, and it was about a local who had friended me on Facebook,
mm-hmm.
and this person said, I wouldn't accept a friend request from them. They're nothing but a lowlife, da, 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 da. And I said, okay, so to my understanding, and this was when I was fairly new coming to church,
mm-hmm.
to my understanding, Jesus hung out with the derelicts.
Mm-hmm.
He was friends with the prostitutes. He was friends with the beggars. You know, like,
mm-hmm.
those are the people that he befriended,
yeah.
and helped.
The lowlife.
I said, so why shouldn't I accept this friend request?
Yeah.
And this person looked at me and had nothing to say. And I said, that is just my understanding of it. That, you know, this
mm-hmm.
is who he was.
That's the Bible's understanding of him.
And I said, you know, so something that I may post, whether it be about my recovery or something I'm going through in life, or just a phrase that I heard that I really liked, you never know who's reading that
mm-hmm.
or who it's going to help.
Yeah.
So I said, you know what? Yeah, I have some lowlifes on there.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I got some friends that are lowlifes.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to walk away from them.
Mm-hmm.
Because you know what? When I look back, there was probably a lot of people that thought I was a lowlife drunk too.
Mm-hmm.
And there was people and friends that I have today that never walked away from me.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not walking away from them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, it's just, mm-hmm. it's the old thing, for the grace of God, there go I.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And you never know where life's going to take you or where a person's been.
Mm-hmm.
So you try to treat them equally, and
mm-hmm.
Whether they're a low life or whether they're mm-hmm. a silver spoon club. So
whether they're Matthew the tax collector that everybody hated.
That's right.
Or Judas the disciple that was secretly stealing money from the
That's right.
group purse.
Yeah.
Jesus did such a good job loving all those guys equally.
Yeah.
That's what he was about.
That's right.
And, you know, he left the choice, really. I guess he left the choice up to them to love him back the same way he was loving them.
Yes.
And some of them chose that and some of them didn't.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's interesting. Because Peter betrayed Jesus, too, when he denied him.
Yes.
But Peter chose to go to Jesus for forgiveness,
mm-hmm.
where Judas didn't.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah, and I like what you said, like, we're all, that word, the derelicts.
Yeah.
That's a good word, because
yeah.
that's what we all are without
yeah.
him. We're all a mess.
Yeah.
And that's why he came, right?
Yeah.
He came, and Tim Keller says he came to die the death that I deserved, to
yeah.
give me the life that I didn't deserve.
Yes.
And so he paid for the sin of all these derelicts
yeah.
called Bob Evans and Vicki
yeah,
Krahn.
That's
and,
right.
But there is that Canadian Christian mentality that we're shiny plastic people under shiny plastic steeples.
Yeah.
And that you got to be good to go to church. That's just a total lie.
No, that's right.
Yeah. You go to church because you're not good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you need that help.
Yeah.
And you need I think everybody in this world is looking for a sense of belonging somehow, somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing, the other parallel to thing that I find is that when I entered the room of recovery, there was people I went to school with that were there.
Hmm.
And you know, huge smiles on their faces and welcome, right? Mm-hmm. Like, glad mm-hmm. to see you here. And the same thing happened when I went to church, right? Was that I walked through the doors and these were my friends and my neighbors, parents of kids that my son went to school with, right? Mm-hmm. And yeah, just, and it's that sense of belonging. It's like, okay.
These are all a bunch of normal people.
Yes.
That's one thing that being a church in a small town, there's a bit of an advantage in that, as opposed to being in a church in a city, because
yes.
when somebody comes to church for the first time at our church, there's a really good chance they know five people already.
For sure, at least five.
Yeah, which helps, mm-hmm. because then you want to stick, right? And our church is really cool that way, and in that way, we're just a bunch of normal people that love Jesus and love people.
Yes.
And want other people to know the love of Jesus. So what would you say to anybody that is... maybe a little skeptical of church, or you know, maybe they're jaded by religion, or they ran into a hypocrite that said they were Christian but didn't act like Jesus and really hurt them and jaded them, or they're just wondering what church is about. What would you say to somebody outside the church about Jesus and the church? What would you say to them?
I'd say, you know what? I'd say come check it out. And, you know, particularly if they were a person that knew me prior to coming to church,
mm-hmm.
or prior, even in my drinking days, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because, so, just come check it out. And you know what? You might have the odd hypocrite in the church, but instead of focusing on them,
mm-hmm.
look at the rest.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one of my phrases that I read out of a book was, when you focus on the negative, the positive fades away.
Mm-hmm.
But when you focus on the positive,
mm-hmm.
the negative fades away.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can use that whether you're walking into a room, a group of people.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to focus on that one negative energy that's in the room, that's how your day is going to go.
Right.
But if you focus on, you know, those people that are enjoying themselves and having good conversation or...
Mm-hmm.
are happy. They say smiles are contagious.
Mm-hmm.
Come check out the church. You know what? Take what you want, leave what you don't.
Well, thanks, Vicki.
You're very welcome, Bob.
Good talk.
Yes.
Good talk. That, of course, is the lovely Vicki Krahn here on the Loudmouth Pastor Podcast. And as Vicki said, just be yourself. God loves you the way you are. Come to church. Just experience the welcoming of Jesus through his people, because that's what our church is about. He's about changing lives, taking us messy people from where we are and picking us up, dusting us off, giving us a new heart. He loves you. So come check out the love of God through Jesus Christ, through his people in the church. We love you. Hope you had a good time listening to Vicki's story. And we'll see you next time on Loudmouth Pastor Podcast. Find us on the iTunes podcast app or anywhere. Just Google us, Loudmouth Pastor Podcast. I'm Bob Evans. Thanks for joining us today.